Welcome back, students. This is the eighth lecture in the chapter of interference. In the previous two lectures, we had studied about interference in a parallel thin film, and we had derived the conditions for maximas and minimas over there. Now we are going to proceed with the next type of film here. It's called as a wedge-shaped film. Okay, interference in a wedge-shaped film. Now, what is the meaning of a wedge-shaped film, and how do we construct or make a wedge-shaped film? So let's try to understand this. So a wedge-shaped film is made by using two glass plates, okay, two flat glass plates, and in between them we are going to place a tiny spacer. So this is a spacer. It's a small object. It's a small object like a piece of paper or a very thin wire or might be a hair, which is the purpose of this spacer is to create a gap between the two slides. So what is happening at this end over here, the two slides are separated from each other, whereas at this point over here, the two slides are touching each other. So what is created between the two slides is a gap, and that gap is not a parallel gap. The thickness of the gap is not same everywhere. It is in the shape of a triangle. Okay, you can see this gap which is created there. It's the shape of a triangle, which you call as a wedge, W-E-D-G, wedge shape. You remember in the for a door stopper and all, under the door we put a triangular piece of wood so that the door remains in place. It has a shape of like this. Okay, so this is called as a wedge. So that's why this film is called a wedge shaped film. So there's a air film in the shape of a wedge in between the two glass plates. Okay, so that's what I picked up from there. So this is the shape of a wedge. Now this angle here is called as the angle of the wedge. Okay, it is denoted by the symbol theta, and this is called as the contact edge. This is this edge here along which the two slides are coming in contact. The thickness of the film there is zero, and from this contact edge, if you move towards the other end, from this point if you move towards the other end here, the thickness keeps on increasing. So that's the basic difference between a wedge shaped film and a parallel film. In a parallel film, the thickness remains same everywhere, whereas in this wedge shaped film, the thickness increases linearly. It's zero at one point and increases towards the other side. So otherwise, in all other respects, a parallel film and a wedge-shaped film are very much similar. Okay, we're going to see the same type of ray diagram which we had seen for a parallel film. Similar type of ray diagram, rays R1, R2, R3 and so on, can also be shown in a wedge-shaped film. Like this. Okay, so this is the ray diagram for a wedge-shaped film. So what we have seen over here is GH is like one glass plate, and GH' is the other glass plate. In between them there is a film. Now this film could be air, most of the cases it is air, but remember if you had submerged this entire setup, this entire thing in, let us say, water, or let us say in oil, then instead of an air film between the glass plates, there could be a water film, or there could be a glass film, oil film, or any other film. So in general, therefore, we are going to say that the refractive index of the film material is mu. If it is air, then very well you can put the value of mu as 1. So now, just like we have done for a parallel film, we start with an incident ray IA falling onto the film. Now, the ray IA falls on the upper surface of the wedge-shaped film at point A. At what angle? Now, to measure the angle of incidence, what I have to do first is I have to draw a normal at point A to the surface of the film. Now, GH' is the upper surface of the film. What you see, this dotted line here is the normal to the upper surface of the film. So the angle into the incident ray with this normal is the angle of incidence I. This angle here also will be equal to I. Why? Because it's a reflection which is occurring there. Okay? This angle here, this ray AB, is the refractive. Remember, when the incident ray IA strikes the film, it undergoes a change of medium. So from one medium to the other, when it goes, the ray splits into a reflected ray R1 and a transmitted ray AB. The ray AB makes an angle of refraction R with the novel. So that's what is shown here, angle of refraction R. Then the ray AB again at point B, it hits the lower surface of the film. There again you will get a ray which comes out, which I have not shown in the figure here. Plus there will be a reflected ray BC. The ray BC again will split into two parts. One will be a transmitted ray coming out of the film and one will be a reflected ray going back into the film. So this process will keep on continuing, and therefore as you can see, you get rays R1, ray R2, R3 and so on. But only R1 and R2 will be considered here, because we have already mentioned earlier, ray R3 onwards are very very less in intensity and they are neglected. So just like for a parallel film, we have got the rays R1, R2. For this wedge shape film also, we have these rays R1 and R2. So whatever conditions we had derived for a parallel thin film due to reflected light or due to transmitted light, those conditions we can directly apply them here to this wedge shape film. The only difference which you need to keep in mind is that thickness T is not a constant here. In a parallel film, T was a constant, whereas in a wedge shape film, T changes. So that's the only difference. Otherwise, the exact condition which we have derived for a parallel film, we can use them over here. Now for this wedge shape film, the derivation will involve only due to reflected light. So that's why I have not shown the transmitted rays over here. So we will be working only with the reflected rays R1 and R2. So again, to find out whether these rays R1 and R2 will produce constructive or destructive interference, we have to find their path difference. Then if path difference is n lambda, it will be constructive. If path difference is 2n plus 1 lambda by 2, it will be destructive. So all that procedure is there. But since we have already done it for a parallel film, we are not going to repeat all that thing again. We are going to directly pick up the conditions for maxima and minimum which were derived for a parallel film due to reflected light, and from that point we are going to proceed further. Okay. So the starting point for this thing, we are going to start with the conditions of maxima and minima in parallel film for reflected light. Okay. So using conditions for maxima and minima, in a parallel film due to reflected light, what are the conditions? The conditions are 2 mu b cos r is equal to 2n plus 1 lambda by 2. This was for maxima, and 2 mu b cos r is equal to n lambda. This was for minima. Okay. So I have picked up the conditions for interference in a parallel film due to reflected light. You can verify the formulas earlier which we have written. These are the two conditions for maxima and minima. Next, what we are going to do is we are going to slightly simplify these conditions by eliminating this cos r term. Trigonometric term, if it is eliminated, it is more simpler to work with, okay? Because trigonometric functions introduce their own problems in that. Okay, so we are going to somehow remove this cos r term from both these equations. And to do that, what we are going to do, we are going to make an assumption. We are going to assume that the light is incident normally onto the film. So what is mean by normal incidence? So suppose I have a surface, okay, a ray of light, suppose it is incident on this film perpendicularly, okay, this is called as normal incidence. Now for normal incidence, the light falls perpendicular onto a surface, how much is the angle of incidence? The angle of incidence I is 0. The angle of incidence I is 0. Why it is 0? Because angle of incidence is measured as the angle made by the incident ray with the normal. Now if you see the normal to this surface, if I draw a dotted line, the normal to the surface will also be along the incident ray itself. So the angle made by the incident ray with the normal is 0 degrees. So therefore, for normal incidence, the angle of incidence I is 0. And also, when the light is incident normally, the ray goes straight inside. There is no bending there. There is no refraction which occurs. So the angle here also is 90. Both the angles are 90. So the angle of incidence also is 0, and angle of refraction R also will be 0. Okay, because the ray just goes straight into the film, into the surface. So if this is the case, then cos R will become equal to 1, because cos of 0 is 1. So this is the assumption which we are going to make in this here. We are going to assume that the light falls normally onto the film So that cos r term will become equal to 1. So we write here, for normal incidence, cos r, normal incidence I and r both are equal to 0 and the cos r value is 1. So with this thing, the conditions of maxima and minima will change to 2 mu t cos r, sorry, cos r is not there, 2 mu t is equal to 2 n plus 1 lambda by 2. This is the condition for maxima, and 2 mu t is equal to n lambda. This will be the condition for minima. So we are going to now work with these two conditions and proceed further. Okay. So now what we are going to do is, in these two conditions for maxima and minima, we are going to put a value of n. Remember, n is an integral number. It can take values like 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. So this value of n we are going to put in these two equations and obtain the positions where maximas and minimas are obtained in the wedge shape film. Okay, let's see how we do that. So positions of minimas and positions of maximas. So to obtain the positions of minimas, we are going to take the minima condition. We are going to take this minima condition and work on it. To obtain positions of maximas, we have to work on the maxima condition. Okay, so let's do that. So for the positions of minimas, so minimas are obtained when the minima condition is used. So what's the minima condition? Minima condition is 2 mu t is equal to n lambda. So we start with this equation, 2 mu t is equal to n lambda. So as I told you, in this now we are going to put the values of n as 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. And we are going to find the value of t, thickness t. Okay, for different values of n, we are going to calculate the different values of t. So let's start with it. So for n equal to 1, sorry, n equal to 0, what will be the, if I put the value of n equal to 0 in this main equation for minima, so n equal to 0 will give me t also equal to 0, right? So the entire thing becomes 0. So if the right hand side is 0, the value of t is also 0. So this thing is t here, it appears like f, so I just rewrite that part here. So this is t. So if you put n equal to 0 there, then the value of t also becomes equal to 0. For n equal to 1 in that equation, so if I put n equal to 1 over here, what will be the value of t? T will become equal to, you can simplify and see, it will become lambda divided by 2 mu. For n equal to 2, the value of t will become, so n equal to 2 here, this 2 and that 2 will cancel out and the value of t will become lambda upon mu. Like if you can proceed further, one more I will just write and keep it, and for n equal to 3, the value of t will become 3 lambda by 2 mu and so on. So you can proceed with this with many more, but we'll just keep it with this here and we'll proceed with the maximas now. We'll find where the for different values of t by putting n equal to 0, 1, 2, 3 in the maxima condition. Okay, so let's start with the maxima condition. What is the maxima condition? The maxima condition was 2 mu t is equal to 2 n plus 1 lambda by 2. So we'll start with this equation there. So 2 mu t is equal to 2 n plus 1 lambda by 2. And in this, again, we are going to put the values of n equal to 0, 1, 2, and 3, and so on. So, first put n equal to 1, sorry, n equal to 0. We will get the value of t as, this check what you will get it as. So, n equal to 0 here, so the bracket term will become 1. So, and then this 2 mu has to come down over there. So if you simplify and check, it will become t is equal to lambda upon 4 mu, right? So lambda upon 4 mu. For n equal to 1, what will be the value of t? Now the bracket term over here, n equal to 1. So 2 into 1 plus 1 becomes 3, the bracket term becomes 3. So 3 lambda by 2, and the 2 mu has to also come down there. So I think the value of t will become equal to 3 lambda by 4 mu. Right? Also, we'll write another value for n equal to 2. What is the value of t? The bracket term will become 5. So 5 lambda by 4 mu. Okay, so this is how we can proceed further and find more values also. So we'll stop with this here. Now next what we are going to do is we are going to substitute this, we are going to plot these positions of t of minimas and the values of t for maximas into the wedge shape film. Okay, so we know the shape of the wedge shape film. So different values of t, we are going to show them in the wedge shape film, and that will give us the exact positions where there is going to be a maxima and a minima. Maxima means, remember, bright, and minima means dark. So let's see now how we do that. So just keep these values in mind. We are going to come back to this and we are going to plot each of these values into the wedge shape film. So I have the wedge shape film over here. So now the first, we'll first plot all the minimas first. Okay, the first minima is obtained at the value of t equal to 0. Okay, t equal to 0. Now in the wedge shape film, at which place is the thickness t equal to 0? It is at this point. This point here is G. This point is G. I think this point was H, and this point was H dash. These are the two glass plates, GH and GH dash, and the angle between them is the angle of the wedge theta. And the first minima is obtained at t equal to 0. So in the film, the point where the thickness is 0 is over here. So this is the point at which the thickness t is 0. Equal to 0 at this particular point. And so this point in the film, what is it going to be? Is it going to be dark or is it going to be bright? It's going to be dark. Why? Because it comes under the condition for minima. Minima means all these are dark points in the film. So this point over here is therefore going to be dark. Minima. Next. Where is the next minima obtained? The next minima is obtained at a value of thickness of the film equal to lambda upon 2 mu. Now, we do not know the value of lambda, we do not know the value of mu also. This could be any values. But all that we know that they are positive. Lambda is also positive, mu also is positive. So, t is equal to lambda upon 2 mu will be some positive number. So, in the film, if this point is 0, this point, the thickness is 0, t is equal to lambda upon 2 mu is some positive thickness. So let us assume that over here, this thickness here corresponds to a value of thickness equal to lambda upon 2 mu. It is some positive value. So it could be anywhere in the film. So let us say this much thickness is lambda upon 2 mu. So this is again going to be a dark spot. Okay, why? Because this is again obtained from a minima condition. Right? Next, the next minima is obtained for a value of t is equal to lambda upon mu. Now, if you check between these two values, lambda upon 2 mu and lambda upon mu is a double of lambda upon 2 mu. If you multiply this lambda upon mu, lambda upon 2 mu with 2, you will get this next value. Right? So, this here, lambda upon 2 mu, lambda upon mu is a double of lambda upon 2 mu. So, if this distance here is lambda upon 2 mu, lambda upon mu will be double that distance. So, if I double it up, so let us say double of this is somewhere over here. Okay? So, this is lambda upon 2 mu. This will be lambda upon 2 times lambda upon 2 mu. So, double of that. So, here the thickness is t is equal to lambda upon mu. Again, this is going to be dark. So like this, we can plot all the positions of the dark points in the film. Okay. For the moment, right now, we will stop with the dark ones and we will see the bright ones where they are. Okay, we'll see the position of the bright ones when they come. So now, if you see the bright ones, the first bright maxima, the first maxima is obtained at a thickness of T is equal to lambda upon 4 mu. T is equal to lambda upon 4 mu. Now, where is lambda upon 4 mu in the film? If lambda upon 2 mu is this much distance, lambda upon 4 mu is half of that, right? It is 1 by 2 here and 1 by 4 over there, lambda upon 4 mu. So 1 by 4 is quarter. This is like half. So quarter will be between 0 and half. So this distance here, I'll use a different pen. This distance here, the thickness here will be equal to T is equal to lambda upon 4 mu. It is half of lambda upon 2 mu. So here, this point is going to be what? Dark or bright? It is going to be a bright spot. Okay? Why? Because it is obtained from the condition for maxima. Okay? These are maximas. So again, the next maxima will be obtained at a thickness of T is equal to lambda upon 4 mu. So this is like 3/4. This was like quarter, 1/4. Okay? So where is 3/4? 3/4 is between half and 1. So here the thickness will be 3/4 T is equal to 3 lambda by 4 mu. This again is going to be a bright spot. Okay, bright spot. So if you see now, if you continue with this pattern, you are going to see an alternating pattern of dark and bright. So there is going to be a dark spot at point G where the thickness is 0. Then next there is going to be a bright spot. Then again there is going to be a dark spot, bright spot, dark spot. And this such a pattern will continue. So what are we going to get therefore? We are going to get a pattern which looks somewhat like this. Okay? They are called as fringes. Alternate dark and bright fringes which are obtained for a wedge-shaped film. So wedge-shaped film interference pattern consists of alternating dark and bright patterns. So here there's going to be a dark fringe. Here there's going to be a bright fringe. Here there's going to be a dark, bright, and so on. Okay. Now here we have said that they are like dots, points. Okay. But actually, remember in a wedge-shaped film, it's not going to be points, but it's going to be lines. Why? Because in this two-dimensional figure like this, I can show only one point in the figure. But when you consider actual three-dimensional film, wedge-shaped film, which is formed using glass plates, at how many points is the thickness zero? The thickness is zero along all these points, all the contact points. So along all these points, you're going to get dark points, dark spots, minimas. So when you add up all dark spots, it becomes a dark line, a fringe. Similarly, let us say at this position here, we get at that point there is a bright spot, but it's not actually a bright spot there, it's a bright line, because at every point the thickness is same, lambda upon 4 mu. So all those points are going to be bright, so it's going to be a bright line. So they are bright fringes. So it's not alternating dark and bright dots, but it's alternating dark and bright fringes as shown in this pattern here. Okay, so this is the interference pattern which we get in a wedge-shaped film. We have an experiment of this also, and you are going to actually see this type of alternating dark and bright fringes obtained for a wedge-shaped film. Now next what we are going to do is we are going to derive an expression for what is called as fringe width. Fringe width. What is basically fringe width defined as? It is the distance between any two consecutive dark fringes or bright fringes. So now if you refer to this figure here, we have a dark fringe over here, okay, and we have another dark fringe over here. So the distance from here to here is called as the fringe width. Distance between any two consecutive dark fringes, or you could very well find it within bright fringes also, okay. Distance from here to here is also your fringe width, and it is denoted by the symbol beta. fringe width is given by the symbol beta. So you can do it for dark as well as for bright, and anywhere in the pattern. Remember, why? Because these fringes are equidistant. Okay, the distance between any two dark fringes anywhere you may measure, or distance between any two bright fringes anywhere in the pattern you may measure it, it's always a constant. Why? Because you can see the difference between this value and this value is lambda upon 4 mu minus 0 is lambda upon 4 mu. Again, if you subtract this value, lambda upon 2 mu and lambda upon 4 mu, you're again going to get lambda upon 4 mu. If you subtract 3 lambda upon 4 mu and lambda upon 2 mu, again the answer is going to come lambda upon 4 mu. So the subtraction between any two values, if you do, the answer always comes the same, lambda upon 4 mu, which tells us that the distance between the fringes is constant. So therefore, you can do the measurement of fringe width anywhere in the pattern you want. Okay, so there's no fixed place where you have to do the measurement. So this is the fringe width. Okay, so we get to derive a formula for this fringe width. So fringe width is the distance between any two consecutive dark lines or bright lines in the interference pattern, and it's denoted by the symbol beta. So we go to derive the formula for that. Let's go back to this figure. This point is already marked as G. This point over here will mark it as P, and this point here will mark it as Q. Okay, so we have a right angle triangle here, G, P, Q, and remember this angle over here is theta. It's called the angle of the wedge. So we have a right angle triangle, G, P, Q, and the angle at G is theta. So in that triangle, we can write in a triangle GPQ 10 theta is equal to opposite side upon adjacent side. So it will become PQ divided by GP. PQ divided by GP, opposite side upon adjacent side. So PQ divided by GP. Now, how much is the value of PQ in the figure there? PQ, this distance from here to here, is nothing but, as it's mentioned above there, it's T is equal to lambda upon 2 mu. The thickness at this particular point here is lambda upon 2 mu, as shown above there. So I can put it as lambda upon 2 mu divided by GP. How much is GP? In the figure, you can see GP, distance from here to here, is nothing but the fringe width. You can see the distance GP is the distance between the two dark bands, the two consecutive dark bands. So it's nothing but the fringe width, which is like it is beta. So I have 10 of theta is equal to lambda upon 2 mu divided by beta, which will give me beta. We are going to find an expression for the fringe width beta. So beta will become equal to lambda upon 2 mu 10 theta. Okay? Now, further, for small angles theta, for theta small, and the angle theta is very small, we can make an assumption that 10 theta is approximately equal to theta. Okay, this holds only when theta is small. And in actual practice, this angle is really very small. Because as I told you, how is a wedge shape film formed? It is formed by taking two glass plates and keeping a very tiny object between them, like a, let us say, a hair or a very thin wire or a piece of paper. So you can imagine how small that angle theta will be. So we can always use this assumption that theta is small and 10 theta is approximately equal to theta. So with this thing, the formula for fringe width will become beta is equal to lambda upon 2 mu theta. So we have replaced 10 theta with theta. And this is the expression for fringe width. Please note over here, in this expression, theta has to be in radians. So whenever in problems and all, remember this value of theta which is there in this formula is in radians and not in degrees. If the value of theta is given in degrees, you have to convert it into radians before substituting in this formula. So that's the expression for fringe width. And now in the special case, if the film between the two glass plates is air, then the value of mu is 1. Refractive index mu is 1. So in that case, the value of beta fringe width will be lambda upon 2 theta. the value of mu is 1. So this is a special case of the fringe width formula for air. For air film. Otherwise, for any other general film like water or oil or any other film, you have to use this formula for the fringe width. Okay. Last thing before we stop in this lecture is an application of a wedge-shaped film, which is used to find the thickness of a thin object. Okay, this is an experiment which you will be doing in the lab actually. Okay, to find the thickness of a very thin object like a hair, okay, or a piece of paper. So this wedge-shaped film can be used to find the thickness of a very thin object. So how do we do it? So as mentioned earlier, the thin object whose thickness you want to find out, you have to use it as a spacer. It's a separator between the two glass plates. So GH is one glass plate, GH dash is another glass plate. And the object which you, whose thickness you want to find out is placed in between the glass plates as shown in this figure here. Then the experiment setup to perform the experiment is something like this. So we use a monochromatic source of light, sodium source. It's a source which has only one color, one wavelength. So let us call the wavelength of this monochromatic source as lambda. It's only one value lambda. That's why it's called as monochromatic. Then from the source, there's a lens through which the light pass. What this lens does is, it makes all the rays parallel. So before the lens, you can see the rays are in different directions. But after the lens, all the rays are parallel to each other. So that's what the lens does. It converts the diverging beam into a parallel beam. Then the light is made to fall on a glass plate which is inclined at 45 degrees to the incoming beam of light. So what this glass plate does, it partially reflects the light vertically downwards, so that the light falls normally onto the film. Remember, we had used the condition for normal incidence assumption. So that's why light has to fall from vertically above onto the film. So the light falls onto the film, it gets reflected from the film and then travels back upwards. Okay? And after passing through the glass plate, it then enters the microscope. And in the microscope, the rays will interfere and produce an interference pattern which consists of alternate dark and bright fringes, which I had mentioned earlier. Okay? So this type of pattern you'll be able to see in the microscope, the fringe pattern. So what measurements are you going to do in the experiment? You're going to measure the fringe width using the traveling microscope. Using this microscope, you can measure the fringe width beta, and also you're going to measure the distance L. What is distance L? L is nothing but the, it's called the length of the wedge. Basically, it's the how long your wedge-shaped film is. The wedge-shaped film starts from the point G and it ends where the object is placed. So that's how long your wedge-shaped film is. So, so with this thing, you can calculate the thickness of the object D. So our aim is to find out this thing, the thickness of the object D. So let's see how we can obtain that value D. So to find the value of D, we're going to start with the expression for fringe width. What is the expression for fringe width? If you remember, expression for fringe width was here. We are going to use this expression for fringe width because the film is air. We have not introduced any liquid in between the glass plates. It's a air film. So beta is lambda upon 2 theta. This is the formula which we are going to use for our starting part over here. So we are going to start with beta is equal to lambda upon 2 theta. From this, we can write theta is equal to lambda upon 2 beta. So let us say this is equation 1. Now further, in this diagram, you can see in the diagram G, H, in the diagram, there is a right angle triangle which is formed there. G, H, H dash is a right angle triangle. So in triangle, G, H, H dash, how much is 10 theta? 10 theta is opposite side upon adjacent side, so it will become H, H dash, which is opposite side, upon the adjacent side, which is G, H. So this will become equal to H, H dash, you can see in the figure there, it's nothing but the thickness of the object, which is D, and G, H in the figure, it is the length of the wedge L. So we have 10 theta is D by L. Further, For small theta, the value of tan theta is approximately equal to theta, so which is a valid assumption I told you already. So we can replace over here tan theta with theta. So from this we can write theta is equal to d by L. Okay, approximately equal to d by L. So theta is approximately equal to d by L. This is equation number 2. So how you got this? Tan theta has been replaced with theta. So tan theta was d by L. So we replace tan theta with theta. So we get theta approximately equal to d by L. So now we have equation 1 as theta is equal to lambda upon 2 beta, and in equation 2 theta is equal to d by L. So from these two equations we can write, therefore combining them both, we can write d by L is equal to lambda upon 2 beta, and from this finally we are going to get the value of d as, because we want to find the value of d, lambda L upon 2 beta. So this is the formula by which you can find the thickness of the thin object like a paper or a hair or a very thin wire which are placing it in between the two slides over here. Okay, so this is an application of the wedge-shaped film experiment. There is another experiment application of the wedge-shaped film which I will stop with after doing that. So it's to find a surface smoothness. Okay, to find the smoothness of a surface. So many times to the naked eye, a glass surface might appear to be very smooth without any ups and downs. But in actual practice, there might be some irregularities in it, some ups and downs, some curvatures, which we cannot see with the naked eye. So very fine surface smoothness or finish of the surface can be determined using this wedge-shaped film. So let's see how we do it. So as just like the application to find thickness of the object, we form a wedge-shaped film like this using two glass plates. Now here the lower glass plate here is the specimen. The specimen means the thing which we want to find out whether the surface is flat or not. So our aim is to determine whether this surface over here is perfectly smooth or not. The surface of this specimen, upper surface of this specimen. The other plate which we use to form the wedge is a flat glass plate. It is known to be flat. Okay, it's a purely flat glass plate. And in between we place any spacer like any object like a thin wire or a hair or something, just to separate and form the wedge-shaped film. So remember, our aim is now to find out whether this specimen which is given here, its surface is perfectly smooth or not. So how do we do it? The same way, the sodium monochromatic source is there. Light is meant to fall on the film using this setup. And from the reflection, you get the from the rays which enter the microscope, you get an interference pattern seen in the microscope consisting of alternate dark and bright fringes. But the pattern will be perfectly straight fringes only if the specimen is perfectly flat. If the specimen has irregularities in it has curvatures, convex or concave curvatures, the fringe pattern also will have curvature in it, just like this. Okay, so this is how we determine whether the specimen is perfectly smooth or not. So this surface of the specimen is perfectly smooth. In that case, the fringe pattern which you will see in the microscope will consist of perfectly straight lines. Okay. Yeah. So the fringe pattern will consist of perfectly straight lines without any curve, without any bends. If the specimen surface is concave, it is dipping inwards, you will see a fringe pattern which is having curvature like this, which is bending towards the contact edge. You can see the direction in which this is pointing, these curves are pointing this side, right? So this is towards the contact edge. This point over here in the wedge is called a contact point, where the two slats are touching each other. So the curvature of this fringe is pointing towards the contact edge. In that case, you can conclude that the specimen surface is concave. If the specimen surface is convex like this, then the curvature is in the opposite direction. The curvature points other side. Which side is that? It's away from the contact edge. So this here is the contact edge. So the curvature of the fringes is pointing away from the contact edge. And lastly, if the surface is highly irregular, means ups and lots of ups and downs, right? Neither concave nor convex, but highly irregular, then the fringe pattern also will be like this type of irregular fringe pattern. So looking at a fringe pattern in the microscope, you can tell whether this specimen is perfectly smooth, flat, it is concave convex or irregular. So this is another application of wedge shaped film to find the surface smoothness of a given specimen. So with this we conclude about wedge shaped film. The only type of thing which is remaining now is a Newton's film, Newton's rings film, which we will be doing in the next class. Thank you.